This tutorial is going to take you through the process of creating posters in PowerPoint, and I want you to notice that creating posters in PowerPoint is the same as creating any kind of other graphic, whether that is a header or a cover sheet, or whether it's even a brochure or any other kind of printed material for your organization. You would often use InDesign or Illustrator for this stuff, but PowerPoint allows you a lot of really nice tools to be able to do something very quickly that looks really good without having to have high-end software or knowing any kind of proprietary technology or material. So we're going to look at brand congruency and the importance of colors and logos. We're going to look at using backgrounds and shapes. We're going to look at smart art, and then we're going to look at what sections you would normally have in a poster like this. And that would include headers and footers, an introduction or introductory section, a literature review or background research, original research, and then your conclusions. So we're going to start by looking at a couple of samples of posters that you could think about how to frame your piece. Often posters are done in either two sizes, 24 inches by 36 inches, in that case 24 inches tall by 36 inches wide, or 36 inches tall by 48 inches wide, or vice versa. It's often 48 inches tall and 36 inches wide. So this is a 24 by 36, and you can see that I framed this in columns, which is often what you do when you're working in posters. I've got my central column that gives the logo of the organization that I've got here. I've got the mission statement or description of my organization, and then I've got some contact information here. This would often be what would be considered the header up here, and then the footer at the bottom. And of course, there's many other ways that you can do this. Often the header will be along the top span, and the footer will be along the bottom, which is why it's called a header and a footer, obviously. But I've broken this out into two sections besides the main piece, which would be the future of communication, and gives me some background, an infographic background and skills that companies want, as well as some quotations from a U.S. News and World Report article about communication skills and the necessity for communication skills. And then I've got on this side the same thing, an infographic on pay rates for public relations, and then some pieces here on another quote, some formative research, in other words, and some jobs or ways that you could go into PR. So that's one way to organize a poster. I want to note that there's a couple of little things that you need to remember to do here. You can think about graphics and editing, and you can see when I zoom in to this graphic that I've actually got a bevel on this graphic, which makes it look really, really nice. And you can also think about drop shadows and those kinds of things. And to do that, you just go into your picture tools and go into format, and then you can edit the pieces from here. I usually would look at something like picture effects, and then you can go to your bevel and you can go to 3D options, which is what I normally recommend. And then you can mess with your shadow and reflection and glow and soft edges and all that kind of stuff, just with a lot more specificity than you can by just choosing a specific preset from your rotation or bevel or anything like that. But think about using those. But the other things are, you always have to make sure to remove your backgrounds. This had a white background on it, and the Facebook logo had a white background on it, and those are really, really important to remove. And of course, like always, you would go to remove background, and you would take out, I'll zoom in here so you can see it, you use the mark areas to remove to take out chunks. You can see here I've taken out those little corners, and you mark areas to keep the little pieces. And notice that you don't just have to click, you can click and drag to do a whole range of color, which is what worked a lot better here to get this Facebook logo to look okay. So from here, I'm going to show you a couple other pieces that are important, and then we're going to go into actual design stuff. So that's communique. And then I'm going to show you one that was done for me by a student in an intro class on Miley Cyrus. And this is just a draft, but it gives you some idea of the different ways, completely different ways you can organize things. So note here we've got a header up top and we've got a footer at the bottom. We've got a nice big graphic to center us in. And then we've also balanced that with another graphic here on the side. And then we've got a kind of chronological discussion of the Miley Cyrus transformation here from the left to the right. And notice that she's used a lot of interesting shapes here. We've got these black lines. We've got this this red shape here that she's then put type on top of. And of course, remember that you can always move things backwards and forwards. So right now, this is on top, but it could have easily have been in the background. And of course, you would do arrange and then send it back to make that concealed. And that's normally what you do with shapes. If you draw your copy on and then you add shapes in around it, that's a good way to go. But notice we've also got these really interesting lines here that you just do from shapes, right? So in your drawing tools, you can make all sorts of interesting shapes. That's this one here. Squiggly lines, etc., to really bring some life to your piece. And notice that she's got some really different pieces here. Like I discussed before, you need to have some areas of interest. We've got the quote here, we've got the graphics, but you normally have things like the introduction, lit review, original research, and conclusions. And here she has a literature review, and notice again this is a draft, so she doesn't have the actual articles in here. Notice she's got the primary sources, which would be her background research or original research, I'm sorry. And here, this actually becomes an introduction, basically, right? And then we've got some conclusions with the implications section. She's also got a timeline, which in many cases, if you're doing, let's say, crisis communication like she is, you might want to have a timeline taking us through the process. So that's one other option. And then I'll show you a template that I developed with another student, which is for medical dramas. And you can see here we just pulled this image and removed the background from online. And this is one way to do it, but of course you could also enlarge this. So I'm going to enlarge, hold down Shift and Control to make it really big. And then I can go through and think about, well, maybe I want this image to be transparent or whatever. And I've covered that in previous tutorials, but of course you would, in a PC, you'd have to create a shape, and then you would fill that shape with the with your logo here, and then reduce the transparency there. If you're on a Mac, you can just reduce the transparency of any logo. But notice here we've got these circles, and then here is where she would put content, and she could have them overlapping, and they could be transparent circles, so that you could have those shapes kind of pop out. All sorts of things, and you can see there's a dark blue stroke on the edges, and there's a lighter blue in the middle. So all sorts of things to give you a sense of structure for the piece. And again, we have the same header and we have the footer. Okay, so now let's go to some ones that are a little bit more complex. And these were done for student faculty collaborative research. This one between Meredith Lax and Dr. Stone from the Department of Communication. And you can see here she's got a nice transparent background. And she's got a header up here and then a footer down here where she's thanking an organization. What's missing from this is, let's say, a logo from Rollins or those kinds of things that might make your organization pop. But there's many different ways to go about doing this. None of those are required. They just might add a different element depending on what brand you want. So you always have to be, again, brand congruent. With Miley Cyrus, it was red and blacks and whites and popping colors. With medical dramas, you'd want to use blues. With communique, I wanted to use Rollins congruent colors, those kinds of things, right? For here, they wanted a lot of dark because that brings out the infographic here, or this look of the brain in behind. One thing to remember is that things on the screen tend to be much lighter than when it's printed. So this actually printed quite dark, which looked great, but you might want to think about that when you're printing. And maybe you want to have your copy directly on a background, and maybe you want to have a block of maybe gray or a semi-transparent white to be able to highlight the blocks of copy that you've got here. But again, the sections are very similar. You've got your introduction, which is the research questions. You've got an area of focus, which is this a word cloud at the bottom and this copy up top. You've got your lit review, which is background. And then you've got your method and findings, which is original research. And then you've got your conclusions, which is the research applications. So that's another example of how to do this. I'm going to show you two more really quickly. Here's one that was done with myself and Kara Russell from Communication. And here again, you can see there's a header up top with multiple colors here to give us a feel for color. And this is done to try to bring in the feeling of law enforcement. You can see law enforcement all tends to have the same sort of color scheme. And then we've got the solutions at the bottom. We've got just one little footer here. We've got the lit review, and then we've got our original research, which is the methodological flaws, methodology, and enforcement complexities. And we've got some pieces to draw our eyes, which are these two major quotes here. One of the cool things about Kara's piece is that she's got this this graphic. I'm going to zoom in here. This was actually made with smart art, and we can go into see what we need to do. And so you go to insert, and you've got smart art, and you can choose from all sorts of different graphics, and you can go to all sorts of different types, hierarchy, etc. This, if I recall, was relationship or maybe matrix. It was the matrix one. And you can then customize. You can see these colors are different from these colors. You can customize the colors. You can customize your fonts, etc. And when you do this, it actually brings up a smart art pane. So I'll show you really quickly what this looks like. So I'm going to drag this in. I'll zoom out. You can see it's quite large here. But when you go through and type, you should be able to actually get the text pane up here on the left. You can type in your bullets, and you can see where they can pop in, right? So I'm going to go ahead and delete this, but that gives you an idea of how all of this looks and pulls together. Notice in the background there is an image here. I don't know how closely you can see it, but it's an image of the globe with some lines of either communications or travel or whatever moving from one to the other. So she wanted an international feel, but didn't want to go too obvious with it. So I've got one more to show you. Or I don't have one more to show you. Never mind. So I'll just leave it at that. So I want to show you how to make a new piece here. And so I'm going to go to PowerPoint. And so here's my normal PowerPoint, right? I'm going to go to File, New, Blank Presentation. And then I'm going to change the size of this piece, right? So if you go to Design and you go to Slide Size, I'm going to do Custom Slide Size. And then I'm going to choose a width of 36 inches and then a height of 24 inches and just one slide here. And then in that case, it's going to automatically go to Landscape. So I'm going to go, and you can change this, obviously. You can change this to Portrait if you wanted to. So it'd be 24 by 36. And then I'm going to go ahead and click on Maximize. It doesn't really matter. And then I'm just going to delete these pieces out because I don't want them. All I want to do is to be able to start from a blank template. And if you go to my tutorial on actually creating a master deck, it'll show you different things you can do here, but you can add in logos and images and those kinds of things. Normally what I would do is I would start with inserting a shape, and that would be my background shape. And well, whether I can do that from just a color or whether I do that from a logo, it's still going to be a shape the full size. So right now, this is a shape that gives us a little bit of a stroke and a little bit of a fill. And of course, you can always go through and change this. You can make no outline or whatever, change your fill, change the type, all of that kind of stuff. So this is basically how you make your presentation. And then you just go through and you add some new pieces here. So let's say I want to make a header. I'll take another box here, another shape, and I will draw it on the top. And let's say I want it to be here. And I'm going to make this a different color. So I'll make this one black, and I can put white text in on top of it or something like that, right? And you can do the same for a footer. So if I want to keep this the same size, I can just copy and paste it, or I can make a whole new shape. But that's really how you go about making your poster. And there's a bunch of things you can do to make this a little bit easier on yourself. If you're in View, you can turn on grid lines, and so you can actually see where you are in the document if you want to center things. And you can also turn on a ruler, and you can turn on guides. Guides are really useful so that you can actually see, here's my center guide, right? And that should give you a sense of where you really want to be. Notice my mouse gives me on the side, on the top, it shows me exactly where I am in space. So right now I'm at 14 inches over, and I'm at 5.5 inches up or something like that from the center. So this allows you to have a lot more control over space. But really, you just need to go through and figure out what design is going to work best for you to be able to make these pieces work really well. So again, your header is very, very important, and that header needs to have your names, your organization's name, or your project's name, I should say. At the bottom, you'll probably want your organization's name, in this case, Rollins College, that logo. You want to have, if anybody has funded it, you should put in what that funding was from. If it's for a class, you should put in what class that's from, those kinds of things. So just think carefully about structure and how you want to place things to really give it the pop it needs. For people that don't know your organization, or your client or your project, but also people who are familiar with it, to give them a sense that they're learning something new from your project. So the last thing I wanted to show you is saving this file. And of course, you're gonna go through and click on File and click on Save, and save it as a PowerPoint file, right? So I will go to my desktop, and then I would save it as a PowerPoint presentation, right? Of course, that's standard. You're also gonna go through, though, and save it as a PDF, and this is really important. Because the PDF should retain your fonts and retain what you've done to your images in a way that the PowerPoint might not. And so you want to make sure that you're on standard for publishing online and printing. And when you're in options, you should also have all, and you should publish your slides. And you don't want to have any of these things in here. And you want to have the bitmap text when fonts may not be embedded. So all of this is very important to do. But this is basically standard here, right? So when you do this, it's important that you tell your printer that they might need to optimize the PDF. And the reason is that sometimes when you have a PDF file, that might actually not look the way you end up wanting it to look. And there's an example here with the communique poster. When I did print this, it actually left gray edges around the transparency of my communique logo and around the Rollins logo. And that's because it didn't embed that correctly in the PDF. So you do want to make sure that that when you are working with these things, that you have the PDF done correctly. So in my PDF here, this is in Acrobat Pro. Often you go to, you should check your properties and make sure the properties are okay, which would be in terms of like fonts and all of those kinds of things. But you don't really need to know any of that for this. Really what you want to do is, when you're in Save As, just make sure that you you do an optimized PDF, and that should take care of it. But you can also do your PDFX, which is your print ready PDF, and that will help there quite a bit. So good luck, guys.